On the 12th of April 2023, an independent energy industry think tank called Ember published this in-depth analysis of the global energy market. The study found that the amount of fossil fuel used around the world will be lower this year than it was last year. That's a very simple sentence for me to say, but it carries huge significance. It's the first time, outside of a worldwide recession or pandemic, that global fossil fuel use has ever reduced year on year. And the study's authors suggest it could mark a genuine tipping point in the transition to renewable energy. Solar and wind, plus nuclear and hydropower, produced 39% of global electricity in 2022, making last year the cleanest energy production year on record. But 39% isn't 100%, is it? It's generally agreed that nuclear and hydropower are both extremely limited for various socio-economic and geographical reasons, and of course wind and solar are intermittent, as our friends in the fossil fuel industry are keen to remind us at every opportunity. If only Mother Nature had provided us with an alternative natural source of energy that was a bit more, you know, constant. Well, of course, nature has provided us with that energy source. It's right beneath our feet in every part of the planet. And no, it's not fossil fuels. It's the effectively infinite supply of heat in the Earth's crust that we call geothermal energy. The problem is we're not very good at getting at it. Current technologies are only economically viable in areas of high volcanic activity or where there are breaches in the Earth's tectonic plates, like Iceland. As a result, geothermal energy currently only accounts for about 1% of total global electricity generation. But buckle up, people, because all that could be about to change. Hello, and welcome to Just Ever Think. It's reckoned that heat contained in the first 10 kilometres of our crust contains 50,000 times more energy than all of the world's natural gas and oil resources combined. The challenge so far has been how to get at it in any kind of economically viable way. There are currently two main ways of extracting thermal energy. The first is to locate an underground aquifer full of hot water and devise a way to bring that hot water back up to the surface, just like we do with oil and gas. The trouble is, as I mentioned earlier, the geological conditions for this kind of simple extraction just don't exist in many parts of the world, so the whole thing is extremely limited in its scalability. Enhanced geothermal systems, or EGS, are a way of reaching less accessible pockets of water by opening up natural rock fractures to create underground reservoirs of water in a process that is not all that dissimilar to fracking. But there's no guarantee that the costly drilling operations will succeed. When the pressurized fluid is pumped in, it might not open up enough decent fractures to make the project economically viable. Plus, the fluid can be contaminated by minerals like quartz and limestone in the rock formation, causing scaling and fouling that can lead to failures in components like pumps and heat exchangers. That, in turn, can lead to expensive delays that can make a project unviable again. The alternative is to forget about finding natural occurring pockets of water and instead drill boreholes deep into rock formation anywhere on the planet, send your own fluid down a network of closed pipes, and allow heat from the rocks to radiate into that fluid before bringing it back up to the surface again. It's a technology currently being commercialised by a Canadian company called Ever. And I caught up with their chief technology officer, Matt Taves, via Zoom recently to get a better understanding of how it all works.
Our system operates on a natural thermal siphon, and it's driven basically just by the density difference between the cold water in the inlet well and the hot water in the outlet well. That drives a pressure difference. And that exists in all forms of geothermal, but in our system, because we just have a network of pipes, we're not forcing water to squeeze through cracks and porosity in rock. It's just a network of pipes. It's more than enough to circulate at our required flow rates for the whole life of the project. And so that removes some of the, you know, classical challenges in traditional geothermal approach, like the cost of installing a pump, maintaining the pump, and the parasitic power demand to run the pump. Those are some of the highest operating costs and account for a huge portion of the levelized costs over a lifetime of regular geothermal, which are just simply eliminated in our design.
So rather than relying on, some systems rely on just getting hot, passing through hot water and getting the heat from hot water and shoving that back up to the surface, you're actually effectively radiating heat into your tubes, and then that heat gets sent back up to the surface.
Correct, yeah. So we just circulate water through these closed well bores, and the heat it's a radial conductive heat transfer is what it's called. So the heat's coming, is being extracted slowly from the rock over time in this kind of radial fashion away from each well bore.
So in your thermodynamics video, if I can quote there, it says, there is a well-defined predictable thermal gradient in the rock that enables an Everloop system to operate for 30 years. So am I right in interpreting that after that 30 years, that thermal gradient has diminished somewhat to make the so that particular installation isn't going to be as effective as it was at the start, and therefore you have to move on.
What happens is that our system has all these multilateral wells, and each well bore you extract heat via conduction, and that there's an expanding radius where you've taken heat out of, and eventually those radiuses interfere or they meet the adjacent well bores, and that we designed that so that happens after 30 years. It doesn't mean that the system just stops producing, but you get an increased decline in the energy output of about 0.2% a year. So the systems will still produce energy for 100 years, 200 years, maybe longer.
Yeah. Okay. So your system is one of the virtues of your system, I guess, is that it could potentially provide what we hear a lot about in the news today, which is this need for baseload power, or some people call it dispatchable baseload power. So can you just talk to that a little bit about the need for dispatchable baseload power and how your system addresses that need?
Sure. So our system basically has two markets or solves two problems. One of them is heat, or which is 50% of energy use in Europe, Northern Europe, and 50% of CO2 emissions. And then the other one is as you put it, dispatchable. We call it flexible or baseload power. So flexible means that our system can actually ramp up and down, and that's actually a very needed feature in energy systems now, rather than just baseload. Baseload itself means flat, continuous operation. That's kind of dead in the market. The markets don't need that. What you need is to be able to pair with intermittent renewables and ramp up and down as required, which is what our system allows.
Yeah, okay, cool. And so you've got some one or two demonstration projects up and running now, is that right?
Yeah, absolutely. So we've, we designed and built and successfully two demonstrations. One of them, we call it Everlight. It's in Western Alberta here by Rocky Mountain House. And that is a proof of concept. It's a loop with two multilateral heat exchange passes. And to put that in context, our commercial designs have 12. So it's a scaled down version of our commercial design. And it was designed to prove and demonstrate three things: that we can drill in and intersect the well bores downhole, that we can seal them with a chemical sealant without using casing, and that we can validate the thermodynamics, that we can predict the thermal output of this, which is the revenue side, of course, and that we can predict that reliably and accurately for a long time. And we checked all those boxes. And that was built in 2019. It's been operating basically exactly as predicted ever since. And then we have another demonstration we just did last year in 2022. And that was to test some drilling technology associated with our ambitions to go deeper and hotter and place these heat exchangers, these loops, deeper and hotter over time in hard basement granitic type rock. And that was also successful in checking off the technical boxes we wanted to check for the drilling side.
And then the plan is to sort of go out to the commercial world and find sites where these things can be implemented. And it sounds like by nature of the system, as opposed to other geothermal systems, there are far fewer limitations geographically to where these things can be situated. Is that right?
Yeah, exactly right. I mean, our whole business plan relies on kind of two features of the system. One is that we're not searching for a resource. We're not searching for an aquifer. We're not creating a reservoir down there with stimulation technologies. We're just So we can go pretty much into any rock type and to any geography. And so it's very geographically scalable. And the other feature of it is that it's very predictable and reliable, both on a day-by-day and annual basis. And so our commercialization strategy is to start in the two markets, which are basically the district heating market in Europe and the power market in the Western US. In Europe, there's a lot of existing district heating networks that are fed by fossil fuels. And so we just have to replace that centralized boiler, essentially. And a single one of our loops can heat 16, 20,000 homes.
And then in terms of just getting the finance up and running and the contracts in place for these systems, I mean, we need, it would be lovely to think we could have thousands and thousands of these all over the world. I did hear recently John Redfern, the company's CEO, talking about a little bit of a frustration with getting institutional finance in place in the US, and actually the companies ended up going to, a couple of the investors are now BP and Chevron, which to the layman's ear is a little bit ironic. And whereas in Europe, I think there's 91 million euros coming from the European Union to fund to get you started in Europe. So is that something that you're seeing is a difference in attitude between the States or North America and Europe, and has the IRA made a difference to that, do you think, in America?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think the IRA, until the advent of the IRA, I mean, there wasn't a lot of large scale commercialization type capital available from government in North America. Whereas in Europe, we received this 91 million euro award from the European Commission, and they're putting out billions of dollars annually specifically for this stage of the development process, this commercialization and demonstration, first commercial projects stage. That's the hardest one to finance. After that, it's easy to finance, but that's the hardest one to finance, and that's where the EU, I think, is really taking the lead. You know, we're at a really exciting stage now. We've de-risked all the technology. We're building our first commercial project. It's funded, as you mentioned, partly by the European Union. After that project is up and running, which will be next year, then we expand massively into our two markets. And we have a huge project pipeline. We have over 200 projects in our project pipeline. And we have about 8 of those are at an advanced or more advanced stage that we're doing engineering and contract work on. And so we'll be expanding through that. But we want to sell this technology, and that's the only way to scale it up very quickly. So we're looking to partner with all different manners of energy firms, utilities, and oil and gas companies as they face the energy transition. Our technology enables them to use their skill sets and what they're best at in a new avenue. A lot of them are looking at geothermal, and it is a needed requirement in the universe of technologies and policies for an energy transition. Geothermal there's a need for it, and it can scale up massively. And I think the timing is right. The timing is now.
I've said many times on this channel that while politicians and lobbying groups waste valuable time squabbling about the climate emergency, scientists and engineers all over the world are quietly getting on with the job of developing technologies that can actually solve the problems that are facing us in the 21st century. The Everloop design is arguably a prime example. And if it's implemented to its full potential, then this system could become a linchpin in the green transition. I guess the question is, do you share my optimism, or do you foresee challenges that we haven't addressed in today's video? Either way, the place to leave your thoughts is in the comments section below, and I'll be very interested to hear your views. That's it for this week though. Don't forget to book your tickets for the Fully Charged Live event in Farnborough from the 28th of April and Harrogate from the 19th of May. I'll be having a one-to-one fireside chat with Robert Llewellyn on Saturday the 29th of April, and I'll be appearing on discussion panels at both events. And you can get 20% off the cost of tickets with this special discount voucher exclusively for viewers of the Just Have a Think channel. Hopefully see you there. Thanks as always to our amazing supporters over at Patreon,
who allow me to keep the channel free of ads and sponsorship messages. You can join them and have your say on channel content in monthly polls by visiting patreon.com/justhaveathink. And of course, you can hugely support the channel absolutely for free by subscribing and hitting that like button. And thanks to everyone who hit the subscribe button after last week's video, by the way. We're getting ever closer to that 500,000 subscriber mark, so we really need your help to get us there. Doesn't cost you a penny, and it's dead easy to do. If you're watching on a PC, tablet, or smartphone, then you just need to click down there or on that icon there, and you will have my eternal gratitude. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.